If keying feels tedious and problematic, here's the faster and better way to do it. Hello everyone, Tim here, and today we're going to simplify the green screen process using DaVinci Resolve. Now, a full green screen setup is a little out of the scope for this video, but we'll do a quick walkthrough right now to show the process, and if this is something you would like to go into more detail on, please leave a comment below and let us know. To start, if possible, the subject and the green screen should be at least 6 feet apart and be lit separately. 5 lights is ideal, with 3-point lighting for the subject and 2 soft lights on the green screen, but 3 lights is possible to work with. At minimum on the subject, you'll want a soft key and a backlight for background separation, and a very soft source for the green screen. Next, use the best chroma subsampling option you can. This refers to how much color information is retained inside each pixel in camera. 4:4:4 is best, but that only really exists on very high-end cinema cameras, and in most cases, 4:2:2 is going to be your best option, which a lot of mirrorless cameras and even iPhones that can record in ProRes can do. In camera, be sure to turn off any auto, exposure, white balance, or focus, as each of them can make keying much more difficult. For phones, I recommend the Blackmagic Camera app. And lastly, be sure to record just the green screen by itself for a few seconds at least. The reason will become apparent in a minute. Now in DaVinci Resolve, we're going to go ahead and add our background below our clips that we're keying so that we can see what it looks like after we do the key. Now I have a clip from my Fuji camera and one with the iPhone 16 Pro from my home setup that I just showed. Now I'm primarily going to focus on the Fuji, but we're going to showcase 3 different methods of keying with it. And we're going to start with the most simplistic, which happens on the edit page. And the way to do that is if we go up to our effects tab and we select Resolve Effects, we'll just go ahead and type in key. And we'll see this 3D keyer. So let's go ahead and just add that to our clip here. And then we have to make sure that our viewer is set to open effects overlay. So we'll just toggle that right there. And then with our 3D keyer, we can make sure we have this pick selected. And then we can just draw on our viewer to make sure we get any of that green screen covered. Make sure we get a really good, nice, solid selection here. And now that's taken out most of our green screen. And a couple little fine-tuning adjustments that we can make with it is we can increase our despill to kind of get rid of that green fringing that we're seeing around the hands and a little bit on the hair. And then the other 2 primary things we can do with it is we can pull down our matte finesse and key adjustments. The key adjustments will mostly focus on how strong of an effect it has on the green screen itself. Tolerance and softness will be how strong it is on the green and how much feathering you want on it. And the matte finesse will primarily focus on the subject and how much of the fine detail, the blurring, or noise you want to adjust as well. And then, of course, we have this little light here that wasn't a part of the green that we want to key out, and we can take care of that with our trusty old garbage mat. And if we go to garbage mat, we select matte shape. We'll go with a rectangle here. And the garbage mat will build this rectangle that takes out anything regardless of whether it's part of the green or not. So we can just move that up here where the light is. And now we have that light taken out. And that's the 3D keyer. So now I'm going to remove this, and we're going to go ahead and actually do the next method inside of Fusion. Now, even if you've never used Fusion before, don't worry, we're going to go step by step with each part of the process. But if you want to understand how Fusion works, you can watch this video where I break down how nodes function and what types there are. So here on the Fusion page, we need to start by putting our camera in a space that Fusion likes best, which is called linear. And the way that we do this is by selecting our media in node, pressing shift space to open the selection box here, and we're going to type in color space transform, and we'll go ahead and select that and add it to our node flow. Now, if we go to our inspector, all we have to do is tell the node what the camera shot in. If you didn't shoot in a log profile of any sort, then you can just change your input gamma to Rec 709. For this Fuji camera, I'll just change it to what I recorded in. Then we need to copy this node with Ctrl-C and paste it with Ctrl-V. And all we're doing on the second CST is hitting swap to go back to what we started with. And the reason for this step is that anything we do inside of the CST sandwich will happen in the most optimal space for Fusion to work with accurately. So the node that we're going to use to actually do the keying is going to be called the Delta Keyer. And so to add that, we're going to go ahead and select this first CST, press shift space once again, and then type in Delta Keyer. And we'll go ahead and add that to the flow. And we're going to talk briefly about some of these controls here, but I'll go into more detail in the third method. But to simplify it, we're just going to go where it says background color and select this eyedropper. And we can do a similar thing to the 3D key where we can click and drag it over our window here, except now we're just selecting a single color instead of selecting the whole screen. To see a better instance of it taking away more and more of the screen, like we did with the 3D key, I'm going to go ahead and undo that. We can select this icon here to turn everything black and white. So now if we grab this eyedropper again and select our key, now we can look and see what the most optimal point is that takes out the most green. So we can select that point and then we can turn this off. And before we adjust any of these other parameters, what we're really gonna focus on is the matte and fringe tab. So if we go to matte, we can increase this low threshold by clicking and dragging the number, and that's going to make the strength of the key stronger. And then we can use some blur or clean foreground and background to clean up any residual noise that we may see. But the last thing that we can go to is the fringe, and we're going to get into a little bit more of what fringe is in the next method. But if you want a very, very simplistic use case, you can just set spill method to medium because that's what you usually use for green screens. And then you can just bring fringe gamma down to take away some of the green spill. And that's the delta key. Now, to remove this light, you can essentially just use a rectangle and throw this into the garbage mat input on the delta key and move the rectangle up here. But I'll show this in a little more detail in the next method. And we're going to go ahead and reset the delta key and move on to the third method. Now, this third method is a little more involved, but it gives us the cleanest result of the three if you're willing to put in the little extra work it takes to set it up. Now, for this third method, we need a second and third node. The second one is the matte control, which is this icon here. And the third one, we can click off the node tree to deselect all nodes, and we'll shift space again and add a clean plate node. We're still using the delta key for the actual keying, but these other two nodes will give us additional fine tuning that will make our key even cleaner and more controlled. So let's go ahead into the delta key and grab our background color to start the key. But now, to better handle fine details, we need to implement our clean plate node. Now, a clean plate is just the full background by itself, which is why we mentioned it as part of one of the setup tips. Having a clean plate gives the delta keyer a better way to isolate finer details to know what it should keep and what it shouldn't. In order to create a clean plate, we need to give it a still image of the background. If that exists in our footage, we can just use the time stretcher node. If it doesn't in your instance, there are other ways to do it, which I'll show in a different clip. But for this method, I'm just going to move these nodes back real quick, click off to deselect the nodes, press shift space, and type time stretcher. Now we'll want to give the time stretcher the full image after the CST. So we'll go ahead and connect our first CST to the time stretcher and the time stretcher into the clean plate. Now let's click and drag the clean plate into our first viewer to load it there. And let's go into our time stretcher node and go into the inspector. And basically all we're doing with this is changing what frame of the footage we're looking at. So we'll select nearest, turn off this keyframe, and then click and drag the frame number until we find our clean frame. Now it's at the beginning of my footage here, so I can just leave that there. In the clean plate, we'll click and drag this eyedropper to select the green. And we need this to be fully green, so sometimes with objects in the frame, they can slightly fringe over our plate, which causes it to bleed into filling it in. So we can just erode that part out and then grow edges until it fills up, or select the fill checkbox for any remaining blank spot. Now we can connect our clean plate to the delta key and it automatically knows to put this into the pink input, which is the clean plate input. And that definitely helps clean up finer details. But what if we don't have a clean plate in the footage itself, like this one? Well, another key tip, pun intended, we can go back and do on this iPhone footage here. Now I already have the node set and the key taken out, but in this instance, the subject is in the frame the entire clip. But we can still make a clean plate out of this. The question is, how do we get as much of the original screen as possible without overlaying any of the subject onto it? Well, we can use this nifty node called Trails. So we'll put it right after the clean plate by selecting it, pressing shift space, and searching Trails. We'll go ahead and add that in, and what this will do is keep anything that it sees from the clean plate. so that any green that shows up gets left in the trails node. And if any of the subject leaks through, we can just increase our erode in the clean plate so that we can ensure that only the green is getting through. So let's just load the trails into the viewer, and we can either skim through it or just let this play through. And now we have much more of the original screen than we started with. Even though we didn't get all of it, that's okay. We have a significantly better starting point. So we can right-click the viewer, go to Save Image, and then we can save this as a PNG. Go ahead and give it a name. We'll hit Save, and then load it in either your File Explorer or Finder, and then bring that PNG back into the node graph and use that as our clean plate source. And then we can remove the trails node as well. Then we can connect our clean plate to the delta keyer, and then to fill in those empty spaces and clean up the key, we can go back into the clean plate and grow edges or select the fill checkbox accordingly and work like normal from there. We'll go back to our original clip here, and the easiest way to check and see how good our key is by going back to this black and white image toggle, which is actually our alpha channel, showing black for what's being cut out into an alpha channel, and white for what's left in. And this is a good way to check finer details or to see if there's any noise or chatter still needing to be taken out. If that is the case, then the best way to take care of it is by going back to the matte tab in the delta keyer. Now, ideally, this isn't necessary, but if it is, I would recommend starting with the clean background to try to remove any chatter or noise, and clean foreground to try to retain subject detail without bringing the background back in. These should be subtle adjustments, and then you can adjust your threshold as well if you need the key strength to be a little bit stronger, but again, you risk losing detail, so small adjustments make the difference. Now, of course, going back to this glaring light in the room, literally and figuratively, we have some extra inputs on the delta keyer to handle that. We have the garbage mat, which is meant for taking stuff out, and solid mat, which is meant for keeping stuff in. So thankfully, in this example, we just have a simple light in the corner to get rid of. So I'll just add a rectangle mask, right-click, and drag the output to the delta keyer so I can choose which input to put it in from a list. And I'll select garbage mat. Then I'll just drag the mask up here to cut that part out. And I was a goof and accidentally got some reflection in my glasses, which the keyer wants to take out. But we want to leave that part in, so I'll add another rectangle node, move it down here along with the other rectangle just to clean things up, right-click, drag to delta keyer, and select solid mat. Now this is selecting what to keep in, so we'll just put it over this spot on the glasses, and I only need it for a brief time, so I can keyframe the level to essentially turn this mask on and off. I'll turn on my normal view so I can see the glasses better. So first we need to go to the end of the reflection, set level to 1 and set the keyframe, and then I'm going to go back to before the reflection starts and then set another keyframe so that we have the range of which it's visible. And now I just need to go one frame off on either side and set level to 0 so that the mask is only visible when that level is set to 1. So for this last tip, I'm just going to turn on this fusion LUT I have set to see the colors better. But what we're going to do is address any additional fringing we have on our key, especially in the motion blur, which is pretty common. And we can do this in the matte control node. So when we select it, we can go to the spill tab and we can already see what our goal is here. If we set our spill color to green, that means we're attempting to fix any of that green fringing we're seeing. The spill method is what type of suppression we're using. Rare removes very little of the fringing, and burnt is typically used for very problematic blue screen shots. Generally, medium works best for green screens, and well done works best for blue screens. So we'll stick to medium here. Spill suppression is the strength of the method. And then we have a few fringe controls. Gamma controls the brightness, size controls the size of the gamma effect, and shape pushes or pulls the fringing towards the edges to keep it from leaking through too far if our size is large. And then we have additional color controls to counteract any residual fringing colors if need be. And overall, I think our key looks pretty decent. Now, there are even more advanced ways to use these tools and ways to use multiple delta keyers and matte control nodes to have even more refined key fills and outline control. But I think we're in a really good spot with this. And that's green screening in DaVinci Resolve. Let me know if this tutorial was helpful, and check out this other Fusion tutorial if you want to learn more about that. It might be the key to your problems.